Last video, we looked at what the state transition graph, or STG, for a very simple single-store program would look like coming out of a typical high-level synthesis program. And just to refresh your memory, here is the printout of the states and state transitions in that state transition graph. And the last step in high-level synthesis is to elaborate this set of states and state transitions, this big finite state machine, well, small finite state machine in this case, into Verilog. So the original test case we were using, if you remember, is called single store. And now that we've run it, the Verilog that's generated for this state transition graph is in singlestore.v in the directory where we ran the program. So there's actually, in the generated Verilog right now, there's two modules. One of them is just a wrapper module, which has the name single store. And then there's single store inner, which is the core of the module. It contains the actual module logic. And most of this you can ignore. So basically, we've got a bunch of reg variables so that we can assign in combinational always blocks to ports. We've got some debug info that you can ignore. You can ignore this temporary storage. It's not actually needed. So the critical variable here is, first of all, global state is the variable which stores what state we're in. So if we're in state 0, global state is going to store the value 0. If we're in state 1, global state is going to store the value 1, and so on. And in this simple example, you can ignore these. These are just variables that track what the last edge in the control flow graph we traversed was. But since there's no control flow, this is just a single basic block, we can ignore those for now. Though in more complicated examples, we'll see that the last basic block register is tracked. So the critical pieces of code here, the first one is this always block. So this always at pause edge clock block is really the state transition logic. And as you can see, that always block is basically just a transliteration of this state machine. So the state machine basically says, if we're in state 0, go to state 1. If we're in state 1, go to state 2. If we're in state 2, go to state 3. If we're in state 3, stay in state 3. And in this always block, well, it's slightly modified. So first of all, now we're in real hardware and we have a reset signal. So when we reset, we go back to global state 0, which is the first state of the program, which represents the initiation of the store in the single store program. Then if we're in global state 1, we unconditionally transition to global state 1. Again, a state could have multiple different transitions. Notice that each transition is conditioned on, in this case, if true, because there's no control flow. Every state transition is unconditional. But it could have a condition if, for example, there was a branch where we transitioned to two different states depending on the value of a variable. So then if we're in global state 1, we go to global state 2, and there's no data to store. If we're in global state 2, go to global state 3, and just ignore this for now. We'll see what it's for in more complicated examples. And if we're in global state 3, we stay in global state 3. So that's the state transition logic. And the other part of the state machine is the instructions that we execute while we're in each state. And that's handled by these always blocks down here, these combinational always blocks. So these are always at star blocks. And basically, notice there's two of them. And there's one that controls the values that are set for these reg ports, wadder 0, wdata 0, and wenable 0, which correspond to, well, wadder 0, for example, assigns to the port wadder 0 on single store inner. And single store inner has a clock variable, a reset variable, a valid, which is controlled by the return instruction, and then write data, write address, write enable, and this debug variable that you can ignore, global state debug. So going back to the controller always blocks, this is the always block that controls the memory write. And actually, for convenience, we've printed out the LLVM instruction that's being executed here. So if we're in global state 0, then no matter what, because actually the scheduler can make instructions conditional, but it's not going to do that in this case. If the global state is 0, then store to address 0, the data 5, and to store do write enable 1. Otherwise, we set everything to be 0, including write enable to ensure we don't do any writes. And by the way, the write address here is 0 because in the test case for this single store that generated the single store Verilog, we said that the 0th argument, which is A of the function, which is denoted by get arg f 0, starts at memory location 0. And so, for example, if we reran this with starting at memory location 1, we would see that this write adder would become 1. But yes, we're going to write to write address 0, then and we're going to write data 5. Now, the other controller is for the valid output. So if we're in the global state 3, then we're going to set valid to be high. And we have an if one here that's going to get optimized away. Otherwise, we're going to set valid to be 0. So basically, if we're in global state 3, we're finished. Otherwise, we're not finished. And in global states 1 and 2, we're not doing anything. We're just waiting for the store to finish because the store takes 3 cycles according to the hardware constraints that we created. Right, store operation has latency 3. So we're not doing anything in the other states. So that's all of the generated Verilog. And there's actually a handwritten test bench, single store underscore tb.v, which tests this where, so we've got like an assert macro and, you know, a test module. And then at the bottom of the module, we instantiate the generated single store module. And we also instantiate a RAM. And I've written this RAM to make sure that its write latency is 3 cycles. And then we have debug address and data for the RAM to probe it. And so in the test bench, we basically set the debug address to be 0 so that we're reading from the value that we should be writing to using single store. We do a reset, so after the reset, we should be in global state 0, and we should not be done, and debug data should be X because we haven't written to it yet. Then we set reset to be low so that we can start progressing through the states. A new clock edge comes in, we should be in global state 1, still not done. Then global state 2, still not done. Then another clock edge comes in, we're in global state 3, and we should be done. And then once we are done, we should stay done. And actually, the C++ code for this test bench, or for this test case, runs this test bench, a single store TB, using single store in the RAM definitions. And when we run it, you'll see that the last line is passed. I should actually delete these. These error printouts are not really errors. That's a sort of bad coding practice on my part. I should really delete those. But yeah, so the test case passes. And for example, if we were to assert valid 0, the test case would fail, right? Because it's actually still valid. The module stays valid once we're in state 3. So that's basically the full walkthrough of how the state transition graph gets translated into Verilog. There's more details as straight data state transition graphs get more complicated. And we can go over some of those examples later. And if you're curious, you can check out other more complicated examples in the unit test that use things like loops, other variables, different kinds of functional units, and things like that. But the Verilog that's generated is pretty boring and pretty boilerplate, and is basically a transliteration of the state machine that you see come out of STG construction into Verilog. So hopefully that clears things up a lot. And in later videos, we'll go into some more advanced examples and more advanced optimizations like pipelining and maybe even things like speculative execution and how to interact with real memories like, say, the AXE specification. So I'll see you in those videos.